kidnappings and armed robberies and all sorts of crimes going on in our society. The bottom line is that Nigerian society is broken. The economy is broken. And this is not a result of the recent governance only, but a perennial issue over several decades. And we have seen our country go to pieces over time, and now is the time to rescue the country and to renew the country, and that's why ANRP is here. Thank you very much. The cleanest, safest, and the most organized country in Africa project. It's a project where we can channel the energy and the passion of our youth to begin to stand up for their country and to take their country, to take it over, as it were, because they are the ones that can do this themselves. So it's going to be a case of, within 100 days, we intend to employ about 500,000 people, at least, of our youth in the security sector. For example, now we've got a big problem with our Nigerian police. There are 400,000 Nigerian police, with half of them doing security man work and being attached to people who say they are big men in society. We don't have much of a problem with that, but anyone who believes that they need a policeman to guard them around must pay, and must pay very steeply. We intend to bring a charge of about 300,000 per policeman attached to somebody. And of course, if you need more than one, the scale goes up because of the punitive. If you need two, you need to pay ₦1 million in a month. And this money will be used to be able to employ more people, even in the Nigerian police. So it's an immediate thing. Right now, it's going on as a scam. And we remember that a certain servant senator did say this as well. He was in the Nigerian police. And he said that about ₦10 billion accrued to this racket, okay, to the sitting Inspector General of Police. Nothing was done in spite of that allegation coming from a very high level. So the first thing is, this system of police guards that are going around with our so-called big people has to be reformed. And whatever payment you are going to pay for having a policeman trained and equipped with taxpayers' money, poor taxpayers' money, whatever you are going to do in that regard, must go into what they call the TSA. That is the Treasury,
Let me ask you to clarify.
It can be done, because that's going to be the disincentive. This is disincentive over time for people not to need to have policemen can go around with them.
But in the meantime, Nigeria is already
under police. Then we're going to employ more people. You got about 40% youth unemployment. Right. Those are people waiting to be employed. Not even our thinking in ANRP, we don't even think in terms of graduate unemployment. We think in terms of post-secondary school unemployment. And we need to catch it from that level. And we believe that we can actually channel a lot of energy into that. At the end of the day, the people of Nigeria are the ones that will keep Nigeria safe.
Okay.
And I think that this is very important.
Quickly, before I move to
your colleague from the APC. But again, yes, if you give them opportunity, yes, there's community policing as well. I also would say that we believe in state policing, right? We believe that Nigeria is now due for state policing. However, how that is going to work is that every state governor, the money they collect now as security votes will be used to pay their state police. And if they don't pay their police, they're going to have insurrection on their hands. But I think that we can manage it now. However, yes, most Nigerians can be trained and retrained into the security services. But not only that, into the environmental services as well. Like I said before about the broken windows theory. When you come to a country that's as filthy as Nigeria is, and I'm saying this with all due respect, you know, then of course you expect all sorts of things to layer on that. And of course, so it's about the cleanest, the safest, and the most organized country in Africa. In terms of organizing the society, we need the youth of this country to take charge, to maintain the environment, to beautify the environment, to ensure that people stay within law and order. And I think we can achieve this. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Fasho.
It's one issue that I always say we shouldn't play politics. Of all other issues, we mustn't play politics with the issue of security. But that has to do with our existence, I mean, as a people. I will tell you that it's not about what we are going to do, it's about what we are already doing. We all know what this government inherited in 2015 when we came in. The issue of security goes beyond the insurgency in the Northeast. It involves armed robbery, kidnapping, and several other, even the Niger Delta issue. But we have to also take that into cognizance that the fact that today, Northeast is a lot better than what it was 3.5 years ago. We are not there yet. Like I said, you don't play politics with security. So I'm not here to 4 years ago in the Niger Delta. And the Ogoni claimed of the devastation that has happened in Ogoni land, which today is being addressed, is the biggest in the world. That is only possible because we have some improvement in security in the Niger Delta. In the Northeast today, I was in Maiduguri a couple of weeks ago. When you are inside the Maiduguri city itself, you would take your Ibadan or anywhere else. We still have issues on the outskirts, and we still have surprises coming from the Boko Haram element. But we all know what it takes the United States of America to, for instance, the issue in Afghanistan. Yemen is there, many other countries, it takes several years to resolve this issue. But I also don't like comparing figures, talking about the dead. It's not something that I'm comfortable with. I want to compare the number of kilometers of road that we have built, the rail track we have laid, not the number of people who died before 2015 and the number of people who died or are dying now. No, that's not what I want to discuss. I want to look for ways of tackling this issue in a way that we would have a far-reaching decision that will make this peace to be more durable. We will not be where we are today. But because they didn't have such policies and the implementation was completely not good enough. So, but this time around, we could see that the most important thing is security. It's tied to your reputation as a country. It ties to the credibility of the government in power. Because you cannot handle security alone without the other communities, countries around you being fully involved. So the involvement of Chad, Niger, Cameroon, and all these countries that are cooperating with us has to do with the credibility of the current government. And the successes we have recorded are made possible because we have the credibility for such countries to work with us. We know they didn't work with the past government because there was no such credibility. We also know that you cannot just tackle security without being properly equipped. Your armed forces must be properly equipped. And you cannot have access to equipment because we are not at a state where we could take care of ourselves in terms of equipment. But we are able to procure the necessary equipment we need because of the credibility of this government. So a credible nation is a part of the condition to being able to tackle all these issues. And I also would want us to understand that the media has a role to play. The media needs to also understand that we shouldn't be expanding or discussing our divides in a way that appear we are promoting it. We should also join hands together to ensure we work and limit what divides us and promote what unites us. This government is very focused on tackling security, and it is a daily issue. We saw what Benue was 10 years, 12 years ago, we saw it. Policies have been put in place to ensure that going into the future, we don't experience this kind of issues anymore. There's no country in the world where you don't have issues that touch on security. And security goes beyond our safety. It includes the fact that if our nation is not secure, then the issue of even economy will be affected, our politics will be affected. In the Northeast, for a long time, the people could not farm, they couldn't go to their farm. And when there is food crisis, then you start talking of the issue of food insecurity. So the people cannot go to farm, the people cannot go out to do their legitimate businesses, then you know that the issue of security is existential. Thank you. To say any part of this country is under siege. We do have cases of attacks, cattle rustling, kidnapping. In several areas of the country, the Northeast, some part of the Northwest. But the issue is, we also need to know that these are tied to economy. The issue of poverty that this government inherited, that we are doing a lot to address. there have been a lot of social investment programs deliberately targeted at ensuring that people are able to earn a living. People are able to feed themselves. People are driven to extreme when they are in state of abject want and they are not able to survive, like every other human being. So you cannot just address the issue of security without relating with the issue of well-being of the citizens. So, and that's why this government takes the issue of social investment program very seriously. And we have a number of programs that have been rolled out. The same money that was applied to individuals by private jets is the money we are taking to the ordinary Nigerian now to be able to improve their own lives and live better. So it's gradual, and we are seeing improvement. The graph is actually going up, not down. And the issue of tackling this as a holistic matter is being addressed by this government. Far-reaching, a lot of new formations for the army, for the police, are being put in the remote areas now that you know that the issue of assets, because assets have been a major issue. You have things happening in far remote areas that the security people don't have access. Now you have confirmations that are very close to these areas, and the effects are beginning to show. But we must not forget that it is tied to the economy, and the economy is one key element of this government's policy.
And now let me quickly ask
you. You admit this has happened. We have, this government has employed several thousands of
10,000
in the first instance. And now, as I speak to you, another 10,000 police men.
Just a minute. Can I please ask
people to be... It's a very important issue in the country today. And the reason why it is important is because national security is of an existential nature. It can determine our lives. It can determine how we interact and how we move around safely in the country. So I want to start by saying that the idea of national security goes beyond the discussions about hiring new police people. It goes beyond the discussion about Boko Haram. What we first have to understand is that the first gamut of the national security arrangement we have in Nigeria goes along four dimensions I talk about. The first dimension is intelligence, being able to find out information, know what is happening. The second one is enforcement, being able to enforce the laws and the rules. The third one is adjudication, being able to take those who have violated the laws to court. And the fourth one is corrective, sending the people that have committed this offense to prison and changing them and then rehabilitating them. So you cannot think of national security only from an enforcement angle. You have to think about it from the whole gamut of national security, which goes from intelligence, enforcement, adjudication, correction, and then rehabilitation. So whenever you see us invest money in security in terms of police, and we don't invest money in the courts to weaken the access to justice, what you find is a deluge of cases going to court and no judgment coming. And when we have a situation where the courts are funded and the courts are taking care of the cases, we find prison yards that cannot accommodate people. So Boko Haram people are not in our prisons, they're in military barracks, prisons are overcrowded, so we don't have people the ability to be a corrective institution. So the article plan looks at the national security from the dimensions of these five domains of security. That our security system, at the underpinning of our security system, is a national identity system. So it is possible that we know that Osita Chidoka is the person that was arrested for this offense and was charged to court and went to prison for this offense. We can track that one individual through the life cycle of the case. What is happening today in Nigeria is that people commit offenses, go to court, go to prison, come out and alter their names and still move in society as people who have never committed any offense. So there is a fundamental disconnect in our understanding of national security. The second one is that our national security failure is because the national security system we operate today came about from what I call the 1986 redesign of our security system. General Babangida, confronted by the military coups, by the, first of all, the NSO under President General Buhari in 1984, became a Gestapo army, became an army for intimidation and harassment of citizens. So when General Babangida took over, and Mohammed Rafinder, the then NSO DG, was arrested and detained, they now talk about redesigning the security infrastructure. So we redesigned it, and we have the SSS, the NIA, the DIA, as a product of that redesigning. The Nigerian police force was expanded to give them more powers. Don't forget, the idea of the mobile police force was to have a force that can intervene on purely civil matters with the capacity to fight like the military. Now, when the Babangida administration designed this security system, it became a regime protection security organization. The idea of the police and the army and the SSS was to protect the regime in power at the day. But today, our challenges are different. We have the Niger Delta militants, we have the Boko Haram, we have the rustlers and the cattle herders and the farmers. Now, you can see that our security system has caved in under this pressure because they were not designed to fight this type of security challenges. I'll give you an example. The Nigerian Police Force in 2016, their budget for overhead, the budget of the Nigerian Police Force for overhead in 19, it was 276 billion, 76 billion. The police had about 9,000, roughly 9,413 police formations. So the budget for fuel in the 2016 budget was 430 million. If you divide it by 145 naira per liter of fuel, that will give you at least about 2.9 million liters of fuel, which looks like a lot of fuel. But if you divide it by 365 days, it amounts to 8,000 liters of fuel. If you divide it by the 9,000 police formations in Nigeria, it amounts to 1 liter of fuel per police station. So there is no funding for the Nigerian police to function the way they are functioning. If you go back again into the issue of recruitment, all these agencies have recruited their brothers and sisters. There is no place in Nigeria you go to and you apply to the police force and the best and the brightest are taking. What you find is a situation where people are taking their cronies. So the Nigerian police force and the army, confronted by a war in the northeast, could not fight because they didn't join the police or the army to fight. They joined it as a business. So I think that at the critical issue of Nigerian security is to first of all talk about recruitment, is to first of all think about the five gamuts of the security: intelligence, enforcement, adjudication, and correction. We cannot have one without the other. Our prison system is a cage. Our prisoners are not fingerprinted. They are not captured in any database of prisoners. Our court system, you cannot go to a court now and get the list of people who we've had judgment against. So the article plan, the PDP, is coming to power with the holistic plan.
30 seconds.
So the article plan is primarily to go back to the fundamentals, review the recruitment process of the police, redefine the national identity card system, and then devise a funding mechanism for the police before we go into the restructuring of the police into community policing, state policing. And then, of course, bringing all the agencies of the security services, from the civil defense, the Federal Road Safety Commission, the police, the SSS, and redefining the definition of security in Nigeria.
Okay, so...
doing what I have said now is something that we are yet that we... The details will unfold as we are working, but just to give you an insight, the police ratio in Nigeria of 1 to 459 Nigerians will clearly not deliver public safety. So we first of all have to think about how to look at police, defining the word police, to go beyond the Nigerian police, to include all the agencies of government that are in enforcement, so that we can begin to leverage on all of them as the policing force in Nigeria. Because immigration is a form of policing the borders. The road safety is a form of policing the roads. The civil defense is a form of policing our strategic national infrastructure. So we should stop defining police as the Nigerian police. but defy police to ensure that the private security companies that work in the private business in Nigeria is captured under our national security system. That the vigilante groups that operate in the villages are captured under the Nigerian police's differences. That automatically will increase the number of police in Nigeria. So this is within the first 1 year of the Atiku government. We should be able to redefine the security system and capture all these people with requisite training to increase the number of policing that is available to Nigerians. The second one is that we have to redefine the recruitment process for the security system. Once you have been captured under the national security identity system, we cannot allow anybody with a criminal background, with a school case, with a courtesy in the university to end up in our security system. So we need to, first of all, redefine the recruitment system, and this is within the first 6 months of the government, to set new standards for recruitment into the Nigerian police and other policing agencies to make sure that even NAFTA is captured as a policing force because they enforce the management of drugs in Nigeria. Now, the third aspect of it is that we have to look at the creative funding of the Nigerian police. So the federal government owns the police, but the funding of the police can be localized. That is to say, instead of 450 million naira being budgeted for fuel for Nigerian police, we will allow every state government in Nigeria to budget for the operational dynamics of the Nigerian police force. 1 year of the Atiku government, we will work out a funding mechanism for the day-to-day operational work of the Nigerian police. Now, the fourth one is the improvement of technology. The Nigerian police and the state security services still lives in the 1960s. Their policing capacity is archaic. There is no way you go to now on the road. It was when I was at the Federal Road Safety, the first thing we did was to institute a system of capturing all the driver's license and the vehicle plate numbers. So that when you stop a car on the road, just typing in the number, if you go to the Nigerian vehicle NVIS.org.ng, you will type in a car number and you will get the vehicle. You will get the details of that vehicle. The whole idea is that we will invest in technology to reduce the need for manual policing to be led by an e-policing strategy that will ensure that we deliver security to Nigerians. And then, of course, finally, we will enforce the police capacity for enforcement, for their capacity to fight, such that the military will go back to the barracks and face the wider national issue of protecting our borders. The Nigerian police force, an elite police force, the Nigerian mobile police, will be turned into a fighting force who will be capable